Hello guys, and welcome to the 6th episode yet of the Cura Advanced Settings 2019 here at Architects 3DP. In the last episodes, we have been studying
the quality and the shield tabs of the Cura Custom Settings menu. Today, as you may have seen in the title, we're going to analyze the Infill tab, the one that is going to be controlling what happens inside the external shell of our 3D prints.
But before starting, be sure to click here in the subscribe button and to ring that bell to be notified when new cool stuff is uploaded. If you do it, it will help me creating new content and growing the channel to reach more special viewers like you.
Alright, so inside the Infill tab, at the first glance we can see that we have two options available. I'm sorry, but I forgot to drop a model here as we always do. I'm going to drop again this really cool STL Mickey Mouse 3D model created by Gabriel Martini, and I downloaded it from my mini factory.
By the way, I will let you the link down in the description in case you want to download it.
Well, so back to Cura, we're going to open this Infill tab. Remember that we are using the profile we created a few episodes ago, that we named Architects 3D PI3 2019. As I announced earlier, this tab is going to control everything that happens inside the external shells of our model. So to see that, I'm going to first go to the Preview tab, click Slice, and then slide down the Layer Analyzer, so we can have a better look at the brain of Mickey Mouse. Actually, I'm going to scale this model to a 200mm high, just to be able to see what's going on inside better.
Of course, I'm not going to print this Mickey at this size, since it will take quite a lot of time and filament.
Alright, so here we are with this huge Mickey Mouse. And now yes, I'm gonna go down to the layer 500, where we have an interesting spot to see how the interior changes. The settings that are displayed by default are the infill density and the infill pattern. With the first one, we'll be able to control how solid we want our model to be. If we are printing a figurine or something decorative and not functional, we can go here with a lower infill percentage. But if we are going to print structural or functional prints, we'll always increase these percentages to have a more solid and stronger object. As an example for that, you can have a look at one of the last episodes of the Architects 3DP Mega Build, where I have printed and assembled the two extruders in PETG with a 45% infill. Changing these parameters will affect the number of lines and empty space we have inside the model. Right now it is set to 20%, and if for example we set it to 7%, as we can see now the grid is much bigger. It is not a problem in the body, but the arms, as you can see, are very empty since the section is smaller. Instead, if we set it to 50%, now both the arms and the body are pretty solid, compare the material used and the printing time, since it's gonna be affected a lot with the infill too. Here in the 50% infill, the print will take 1 day and 4 minutes, and we'll use 314 grams of filament. If we change it back to 20%, now both the arms and the body are filled enough, and the printing time has been reduced to 16 hours and 44 minutes, and the filament used is 188 grams, almost half of the one we used before.
This infill setting will affect all kinds of infills, independently of the pattern we are using.
As you can see, by default the grid infill is selected. If we set it to lines, we can see that now the grid cells have half of the size than before, since each layer will have the lines in only one direction, and the infill percentage is still the same. If we select triangles, the pattern will change as well to a triangle grid, same with the 3-hexagon pattern and all the others. Here you can have a preview of all the patterns in Cura using a 20% infill. By default, I'm going to continue with the grid pattern, and we're gonna continue analyzing the next options from the settings visibility menu. The first option is disabled, since we only have one extruder. Then infill density and pattern are the ones we analyzed. And inside we also have infill distance that is going to control the distance in between two parallel lines of the grid. I am not going to use it, by the way. The connect infill lines option, I don't know if it has been added in the latest version of the software, but I'm going to try it since I think it can be very helpful. I'm going to activate it, and now as you can see, once one line of the grid is extruded, instead of stop extruding and continuing the next line, it will make a continuous extrusion, covering as well the perimeter of the print, what will increase the adherence too. I'm definitely going to keep it activated, and I'm gonna continue with the next options. Next, we'll be able to control the directions and offsets of the infill, what I don't really think is very important, and then we have randomized infill start.
Normally, the infill starts being printed in the same spot every layer. Well, so as you know, sometimes where the plastic starts being extruded, the line of plastic can start being weaker. If we activate this option, this spot will be randomized every layer, reducing the risk to make weak every time the same line in the same spot. But all that for a cost of longer print times, and that's why I'm not going to activate it. But of course, feel free to try it out and let me know in the comment section what results did you get.
Next, the infill line multiplier will change the number of lines we have on the grid. Instead of using one line to make the cells, we can have two, three, or whatever amount of lines we want. I personally don't like this feature and I'm going to skip it. Same with extra infill wall count. This will multiply infill walls that will be printed in the interior of the perimeter walls. We don't really need this either, since we already activated the connect infill lines option. Next, we have an option that I'm going to activate, and it's this infill overlap percentage. By default, it's set to 10%, and it will control how much the infill will overlap the inner walls of the object. We can see the effects more clearly if we set it to 100%. As you can see now, the orange lines are overlapping completely the green line, that is the inner wall. I'm going to set it to 12%, since it is always good to have a good connection in between the infill and the walls. The next option I'm gonna display here is the gradual infill steps, a really cool one that I'm going to explain you real quick. Do you remember the printing times if we compare a 20% infill and a 50% infill? Well, so here you have them. Now if we compare the gradual steps with a 50% infill, what it is going to do is to maintain this 50% infill, but only below the ceiling of the shell, reducing this percentage as far down from it we go. And it will reduce it as many times as we set here. I'm going to set it to 3 for this example. As you can see in the center of the head, we'll have an infill that is very similar to the 20% we had before. But as we go up to the ceiling of the shell, we can see how the infill is increased as we go farther, reaching a 50%. This way we'll still have a really good support in the ceilings, while reducing considerably the printing times as you can see here in this table. Now it features 15 hours and 14 minutes and 178 grams. If we set it back to 20%, it will do the same, maintaining the 20% infill right below the shell, and keeping the interior of the model almost completely hollow. I'm going to scale the model back to its original scale to see how it actually affects. As you can see, with the 3 gradual infill steps, the print will take 1 hour and 14 minutes. If we set it back to 0, now it will take 1 hour and 39 minutes, being more strong. So I'm going to let it at 0, but I'm going to keep this option displayed, since as you have seen, can be very useful for bigger prints. Back in the settings visibility menu, we have quite a lot more options that I personally don't like and I think I've never used. We have options such as the infill step height to limit the steps in the infill. I think Cura does it automatically pretty good. Then the option to print the infill before the walls, that by default is activated, and I like to let it as it is. Also, we find infill support, what will make infill only below the parts that need support. I don't really like this option, since it will make your printed objects way less strong, and you will need to make 5 or 6 perimeters to keep it solid. Then we'll also find the settings to control the parameters related with the skin of the model that I don't really like to change. And that's all for this tab, guys. As you can see at the end of this episode, we have displayed infill density that we have set to 20%, we also set grid as the infill pattern, we activated the option connected infill lines, set at 12% infill overlap percentage, and set the gradual infill steps to 0 for this particular model. But we will definitely use it for larger models, as we saw in the video. Finally, what I'm going to do is to update the configuration file we're using in this series, and for that we'll go here in Profile and choose the option Update Profile with Current Settings, and we are ready to go! As always, I have printed the same model at the end of this video, and here we have it compared with the Mickey model printed in the last two episodes of this series. In the next video, we'll study the Material tab, a tab that is going to drive you crazy if you don't configure it really well. Definitely stay tuned for the next video, guys!
Finally, I just wanted to ask you to subscribe to Architects3DP if you still haven't, hit the like button, leave a comment, and share this video so more people will be able to enjoy with this project. And as always, a special shout out to our Patreon supporters for making this channel possible. If you want to join them and support the channel as well, you can do it navigating to patreon.com/architects3dp, clicking here in the top right corner, or in the link in the description. Remember that becoming a Patreon, you will get access to all the necessary components for this project, as well as all the past projects in the channel, and much more rewards that you can check in our Patreon page. Okay guys, so as always, see you in the next video!